Hello, my sisters and brothers in Christ, and everyone tuned in to our Springfield Zone Fall Rally. My name is Debbie Rodenberg, and I'm the president of the Zone. In normal times, 90 women would be attending, but I believe our virtual rally is the silver lining in our COVID cloud, and that many more will hear about our Lord and the work we do in His name through this broadcast. So, welcome to our rally, and I open it now in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. The theme of our rally is found in 1 Peter chapter 3, verse 8. Finally, all of you have unity of mind, sympathy, brotherly love, a tender heart, and a humble mind. We pray. Lord, bring these words to fruition in us today and always. Let your Holy Spirit work within us to help us to be mindful of others, especially in these trying times. Help us to be sympathetic and tender-hearted, and to give everyone the benefit of the doubt as you show your love to them through us. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Pam Gross, our Vice President, will now lead us in the pledges to the cross and the flag. Following the pledges, Pam will introduce our speaker, Dr. Ken Sherb. Pam?
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic of which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. I pledge allegiance to the cross of our Lord Jesus Christ and to the faith for which it stands, one Savior, eternal, with mercy and grace for all. So help me God. Since 2017, Reverend Ken Sherb has been administrative assistant to the President for Missions, Evangelism, Stewardship, and Human Care in the Central Illinois District of the LCMS. He graduated from Concordia Teachers College in Seward, Nebraska, BSED. Concordia Theological Seminary, Fort Wayne, MDiv, STM, and the Ohio State University, MA, PhD. Previously, he spent a total of 19 years as a parish pastor in two congregations, Peace Lutheran Church in Bern, Indiana, and Zion Lutheran Church in Moberly, Missouri. He also served as a theology professor at Concordia College, Ann Arbor, and has occasionally taught on an adjunct basis for Concordia Theological Seminary, Fort Wayne. Presently, he is a book review editor of the Concordia Historical Institute Quarterly. He has been a member of the Board for Youth Ministry, the Commission on Theology and Church Relations, the Committee for Convention Nominations, and the Board of Governors of Concordia Historical Institute. During the 1990s, he worked for 7 years as an assistant in the office of Synodical President A.L. Berry. While a parish pastor in Missouri, he also served as vice president of that district. Dr. Sherb and his wife Lana met at a church in Columbus, Ohio. They have two grown children, one son-in-law, and three grandchildren.
Good day to all you LWML ladies at your fall rally. I am delighted to be able to be with you for this in a virtual format. I don't know if it's ever been done before quite like this, but we're doing it now. My name is Ken Sherb. I am the administrative assistant to the district president of the Central Illinois District for, among other things, missions. And that's what I want to talk with you about today, because the Lutheran Women's Missionary League obviously has a big interest in missions. The Central Illinois District consists of about 150 congregations of the Lutheran Church Missouri Synod, their pastors and other professional church workers, and we are banded together in a common confession of faith in Christ, which we had already before these congregations became members of the Synod, and in order to do certain things, helping one another and working together, hence this theme, working together in Central Illinois District missions. The Central Illinois District has four big mission areas, ambitious ones, that I want to describe to you today. Ministry in the Spanish language has been going on in the Central Illinois District for a while now, and maybe one of the places you might not expect for it to be going on is in Beardstown, Illinois. Population about 6,000 people, and roughly one-third of those are Latino, and their native language is Spanish. Vicar Tyler McMiller has been at St. John Lutheran Church in Beardstown for the 2019-2020 academic year. Just at the end of the summer, he went back to seminary for his last year. Vicar McMiller is the last in a series of vicars that the Central Illinois District has provided to St. John Lutheran Church in Beardstown, men who could actually preach and teach in Spanish, which is a big need in that community. I had a chance to talk to Vicar McMiller just here recently before his vicarage ended, and one of the things I asked him about was what it was like to do Hispanic ministry in a relatively small community. Here's a bit of what he told me.
Beardstown, Illinois it's a small town with a big and a large percentage of Hispanics. So that it's an interesting place to do Hispanic ministry. It's relatively small. It's about maybe 8,000-9,000 people. And I think, but the percentage of Hispanics is probably 30-40%. So that's pretty high. And that has its advantages and it has its disadvantages. The advantage of doing outreach in a small town is Hispanic outreach in a small town is the same advantage you would probably have in any small town. Everyone knows you, you know them. You get a reputation very quickly. And St. John's has a reputation in the Hispanic community for being loving, for being kind, for trying to get Hispanic ministry for a long time, making a valiant effort for many, many years. So you're able to have a very large footprint very quickly. And your reputation in the community counts. Thankfully, St. John's has a very good reputation. The second thing that I would mention of doing Hispanic ministry in a small town, and this isn't quite the case in Beardstown, but generally, you're almost the only show in town. There is a Pentecostal church that's Hispanic, that's Spanish speaking, and they're pretty big. And there's also an Adventist Spanish speaking church in Beardstown. So there is some competition. There isn't much competition though with the Roman Catholics. Now, the Roman Catholics do have services in Spanish. They do have mass in Spanish, but it's the priest does not speak Spanish. And I think that's simply because Beardstown is such a smaller community that they would have a hard time getting a Spanish priest here. So that makes it interesting for me, and that allowed a lot of the women who have attended my Bible study actually did consider themselves Roman Catholic. That's another thing. I always called it a Spanish Bible study. I never really called it. A few times we did something that I called an actual worship service, but we did a Bible study, and I would invite the Roman Catholic people that I would meet to this Bible study. Now, it was very liturgical. We had a confession and absolution of sins. We had Pastor Evanson do the benediction at the end in Spanish. That was another thing that we learned. But I tried to keep it casual. I tried to keep it to seem like a Bible study. Well, anyway, because it's such a small community, there wasn't a Roman Catholic priest that spoke Spanish. And that really allowed for a large opportunity. There was less competition than there would be in Milwaukee, Chicago.
Some of you recognize the person performing the baptism there is not Vicar McMiller. That's Pastor Pablo Dominguez, who for years now has been a Central Illinois District missionary up in the Quad Cities. He is now pastor at Christ the King Lutheran Church, Cristo Rey Lutheran Church in East Moline, and he came down to Beardstown every now and again to lend help there. Here, he's doing a baptism at Beardstown, but the picture here gives me a chance to note that we have ministry in Spanish going on also in the Quad Cities in East Moline, and Pastor Dominguez is still there doing that at Cristo Rey Lutheran Church. Ministry on the college campus, it becomes more and more complex all the time. The college campus itself can be a forbidding and foreboding place for young people when they're first off, away from home, experiencing new things, making new friends, encountering new ideas that they may not have counted on in the past. Campus ministry can be very isolating because the campus can be isolating for these students. That's why our synod has the motto, "College is tough, you need Jesus, we'll help," trying to gather these scattered folks and bring them into Christ's flock, both the churched and the unchurched. And so the Central Illinois District has maintained campus ministries for some years at the University of Illinois, at Eastern Illinois University, at Western Illinois University, and at Illinois State University. You got to kind of take our word for us that this is a picture from Illinois State. Actually, you don't have to take our word entirely because the man in the background of that picture, standing in profile talking to somebody, is Pastor Bill Jensen, our campus pastor at Illinois State. In order to support these campus ministries for the future, the Lutheran Legacy Foundation of Paris, Illinois, has come up with a great idea, and we are promoting it under the name Keeping Christ on Campus. Lutheran Legacy has created four endowments, one for each of these current campus ministries. And not only did they create these endowments, they actually put $10,000 in each of the endowments just to start with. But they're not even done there. They have offered to match 100%, dollar for dollar, contributions that are made to each of these endowment funds by July 1st, 2021, up to $10,000 for each fund. That means that by the end of next summer, there could be potentially $30,000 or more in each of these four endowment funds. Keeping Christ on Campus is an invaluable thing for us because the district has less money as time goes by for us to support campus ministry out of the district budget straight on. As a result, it's important to keep these ministries going, and the endowment funds will provide us a way in which to do that. We think of the Bible passage from Psalm 43. "Send out your light and your truth, let them lead me. Let them bring me to your holy hill and to your dwelling." That's what we're attempting to do with college students. Keeping Christ on Campus, sending out the light of Christ and the truth of Christ. By the way, in 2019, we got the four campus ministries together for a big campus ministry retreat here in the district out at Camp Silka. And we hope to do more things like that in the future. Keeping Christ on Campus, the endowment funds, are going to enable us to do this kind of thing into the future. If you want more information on the endowments, you can give a call to the district office, telephone 217-793-1802. Find us on Facebook, facebook.com/CIDLCMS. Or go to the district website, www.cidlcms.org. When you go to the district website, look at the home page, and in about the middle of the home page, you find a box there circled in this depiction for Keeping Christ on Campus. We hope that a lot of people donate to these endowments, and we thank you in advance for helping us to make a lasting impact with the gospel on the lives of these young people. Oh, and by the way, there's one more thing I should point out with respect to campus ministry that we haven't talked about so far. It's always important in the fall of the year as new students are coming to the campuses. We don't know necessarily who they are or where they are unless we find that information out from people in their home congregations, LWML societies, potentially from you. So you can send contact information on your students away at college so we can connect them to a campus ministry. And they don't even have to be going to school here in the state of Illinois. If you've got students away at home, send the contact information to me, kscherb@cidlcms.org. I have worked in the Central Illinois District for about 3 years now. And so I can still kind of brag on the district for things that happened long before I got here. And one of the things that I find most commendable in the Central Illinois District mission array is that this district has never backed off on its commitment to campus ministry. It's also never backed off on its commitment to deaf ministry. And deaf ministry is really worthy of our support. I mean, if you just sort of think about it in common sense terms, it may not be surprising to you that the vast majority of deaf people are unchurched. Well, of course. They're not going to go to a church because they know that as soon as they get there, so much of what is going on is going to depend upon them being able to hear. They can't participate, even if they want to, in most church services because they can't hear the music, they can't hear the scriptures being read, they can't hear the prayers, they can't hear the sermon. Deaf ministry becomes a very important priority. And I won't say that the Lutheran Church Missouri Synod has been just great about deaf ministry, but we've got a much better track record than a lot of church bodies. For example, for years there was the Lutheran School for the Deaf in Detroit, which has now become Lutheran Special Education Ministries. Here in the Central Illinois District, we actually have a district-supported line item in the district budget, deaf ministry. We're only one of two districts in the Missouri Synod that actually still support deaf ministry in that particular way. And we think it is important. We would like, in fact, for more deaf ministry efforts to be made. Pastor Tom Phillips has been doing deaf ministry here in our district for almost 20 years. He is the pastor at Christ Lutheran Church for the Deaf in Jacksonville. Recently, I had a chance to talk to Tom, and I asked him about how you manage to serve deaf people who are obviously not all just in Jacksonville. They're spread out all over the state and all over our part of the state. So what do you do to serve this sort of scattered flock? Here's what he told me.
Well, similar to many populations with disabilities, the deaf in Illinois are scattered all across the state. And oftentimes, there may only be a handful of deaf folks in a given community. For this reason, we're organized in a rather unique way. We're organized in a district-wide deaf parish. That's an area covering roughly the same size as the Central Illinois District. In this parish, we have two sorts of membership: regular and associate. Regular membership is just like a typical LCMS congregation with baptized and communicant members. And they participate in a deaf parish very similarly to in a regular hearing parish. Associate members are members of hearing congregations that may or may not participate much in their hearing congregation because of their disability. And so they have the opportunity to join the deaf parish. In the deaf parish, they can participate in the decision-making, they can vote, they can hold parish-wide office, and help in the direction of the deaf ministry in the district. And so you can see we're set up in a fairly unique way.
Okay, so what does that look like in practice, Tom?
Well, while our main office is in Jacksonville, there may exist any number of preaching stations across the Central Illinois. All the locations operate under one constitution and bylaws, but they also have a certain amount of autonomy and leadership based on what the local circumstance requires. The largest preaching station is Christ Lutheran Church of the Deaf, Jacksonville. A smaller preaching station is Christ Lutheran Deaf Fellowship, Bloomington Normal. We also have a fluctuating number of Bible studies in various towns, depending on the local requests. Our voters assembly meets at Camp Silka, or one of the preaching stations, twice a year. We talk about the elections, and we also do our parish financial planning. The business of the parish is carried on by the leadership team. The leadership team is basically the parish offices, the representatives from each of the preaching stations, and of course, the missionary pastor. If you'd like to learn more about Christ Lutheran Church of the Deaf in Central Illinois, then please send an email to IllinoisDeafLutherans@hotmail.com. And also be sure to visit our website, which is right here at www.IllinoisDeafLutherans.org. And also like us on Facebook.
In Matthew 25, Jesus said in the judgment scene to the sheep at his right, "I was in prison and you came to me." Obviously, Jesus thought it important to visit prisoners, and for obvious reasons. The prisoners can't come to you. They can't go to church. But even more than that, prison is an environment where the law is everywhere. It's everywhere, from the weapons on the sides of the guards to the bars behind which you live. You're reminded of law and guilt and death again and again and again. And that's why prison ministry is so important. In our district, we have had prison chaplains who have been paid. We've also got some volunteer prison chaplains, one of whom is Pastor Rod Blomquist, pastor at Trinity Lutheran Church in Taylorville and a member of our district human care committee. He has been a volunteer in prison ministry at the Taylorville Correctional Center ever since it opened. And I'm very pleased to say that Pastor Blomquist, who is transitioning into retirement, has accepted the challenge to take on a position really coordinating prison ministry more and more here in the district as we try to expand it. I asked Pastor Blomquist to give us a little bit of an idea of why he thinks, from his vast experience in it, that prison ministry is so important. Here's what he said.
I am Reverend Rodney Blomquist, pastor at Trinity Lutheran Church in Taylorville. I also have been serving Taylorville Correctional Center for almost 30 years, ever since it first opened. I go there once a week to do a Bible study, once a month to lead a chapel service, and once a month I go in there and give communion to the confirmed Lutherans that are present at the correctional center. And I mention that because there's a story that I want to share with you about the effect that you have on these men that are in the correctional center. Had a young man attend the Bible study one day at the encouragement of those who were already attending the Bible study. He had been confirmed in the Lutheran church. He had gone through parochial school 8 years. But while he was in junior high, his father had a stroke, and shortly after that passed away. Then they lost the farm. In high school, he became bitter toward God and the church and fell away and fell into an addiction with meth. Well, that got him incarcerated. And in his incarceration, he began to work on his anger issues and his addiction. And at the encouragement of those men that were attending my Bible study, they kept telling him, "If you're a Lutheran, you need to go to Pastor Blomquist's Bible study." And he finally did. And in that Bible study, we were reading a passage from Titus, and the passage that said, "God does not lie." I didn't think much of that statement, but it touched his heart. And after the Bible study, I talked to him. I said, "Well, you're confirmed Lutheran, so why don't you come Wednesday to the communion service?" And he did. And at the communion service, I used the old red hymnal, the TLH. And he was so excited. He knew it word for word. And after that, he never missed a Bible study, a chapel service, or a communion service. I don't know where he's at now, but that's the effect you have on these men. It was the Sunday school teachers, the pastors, the parochial school teachers, all those people in his past that brought him the Word of God and taught him about the sacrament. All those people put that word into his heart. And as the passage says, train them while they're young, they will return to it when they're old. That had an effect on that young man. He returned to Christ Jesus. When you support your pastors, your teachers, deaconess, and other fellow workers to go into these jails, into these prisons, Oftentimes, it's regaining a soul. At the same time, oftentimes harvesting new souls. But that's the support that you've given to these people. And that's the support to prison ministry. As you continue to support locally, district, and national ministries, the Word of God oftentimes goes in. And there's times in which we reclaim the soul. And so, again, we wait for those great words from Christ Jesus that day when he says to each and every one of us, "Well done, good and faithful servant." Thank you for your support for the prison ministry. God bless you, and thank you for listening.
Thank you so much, Pastor Sherb, for bringing us up to date with the mission activities of our Central Illinois District of the Lutheran Church Missouri Synod. At this time, I ask you to join me in saying the LWML pledge. Then we will welcome our district junior counselor, our very own Pastor Gaylord Spilker, who will present our Bible study entitled Working Together. In fervent gratitude for the Savior's dying love and his blood-bought gift of redemption, we dedicate ourselves to him with all that we are and have. And in obedience to his call for workers in the harvest field, we pledge him our willing service wherever and whenever he has need of us. We consecrate to our Savior our hands to work for him, our feet to go on his errands, our voices to sing his praises, our lips to proclaim his redeeming love, our silver and our gold to extend his kingdom, our will to do his will, and every power of our life to take the great task of bringing the lost and erring into eternal fellowship with him. Amen.
Welcome to our Bible study for the LWML Fall Rally. Our theme this year is Working Together, our Bible study. And it's different this year where we're not in person, but God's blessings to all as we take a look at his word of working together. Our first beginning here is speaking from the beginning, God did not want his people to be alone or isolated. Our Lord said originally, it is not good for man to be alone. He desires that fellowship. The Lord made each one of us, placed us in a family, in community, in a congregation. He's the one who has us where he wants us, and we are hearing his word to be there because we are sinners, and working together with others sometimes can be challenging. And in this Bible study, we will see God's framework for accepting others and how, with God's help, different personalities can work together towards a common goal. We begin then with our opening prayer. Heavenly Father, by your hands you fearfully and wonderfully made each one of us. You so graciously gave us life, and through your Son's victory over sin and death, you gave us eternal life. Open our hearts and our minds today to receive your words of peace and love as we strive to work on our relationship with others. Help us to work together in love with tender hearts and humble minds to serve you and others. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. Our opening scripture verse from 1 Peter 3. 8, finally, all of you have the unity of mind, sympathy, brotherly love, a tender heart, and a humble mind. That unity of mind, we might say, what is the best unity of mind that we can have? How can we all be together? Well, if you would all do it the way I say, then we could be united. There's something wrong with that, isn't there? That's not how the best way we could grow, by just having one person's opinion. Without unique ideas and fresh perspectives, would our society, workplace, and community be a place to learn, to grow, and be inspired? Instead of, what would these places be? What would it be like all one person's idea? No, we're one body together, and we keep looking to, what does it really mean
to be unity of mind. And we have to take a look at, we have the example of three persons in the Trinity, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, yet they're one God, and He desires His body to be that one also. In Romans, He says, "For those who live according to the flesh set their minds on the things of the flesh, but those who live according to the Spirit set their minds on the things of the Spirit." If we continue to constantly focus inwardly on ourselves, having our minds set on serving only us individually, we will have zero ability to be able to work with others. But there's good news. Even though we're all sinners and we all fall short, there's good news that He has for us. Our Lord has rescued us from the sinful, flesh-focused self. Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior, died on the cross for us, and our selfishness is forgiven, and now the Holy Spirit gives us the ability to set our minds on things of the Spirit. Amen. Yes, He has that good news for us. How about Galatians 5, 22 and 23? What does that really say? But the fruit of the Spirit is what? Love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, self-control. Against such there is no law. What are these things? Yes, all of these fruits of the Spirit are there. They're not our spirit, they're fruit of God's Spirit flowing in and through us. Philippians. Take a look at Philippians 2, 1 to 4. So if there is any encouragement in Christ, any comfort from love, any participation in the Spirit, any affection and sympathy, complete my joy by being of the same mind, having the same love, being in full accord and of one mind, doing nothing from selfish ambition or conceit, but in humility count others more significant than ourselves. Let each of you look not only to his own interest, but also the interest of others. Consider what others are going through and their ideas also. As Christians, we can have that unity of mind even if we may not all agree on how some things should be done. How can that oneness, how can that unity be established? First of all, it's a studying of God's Word. His Word is truth. And then we're one baptism. We're all baptized into one body. We're connected with one another. And then that fellowship that we have with the Lord's Supper, all one gathered around the table of our Lord, fellowshipping with Him and with one another. Taking a look back at our beginning Bible verse, it really focuses on those. It says 1 Peter 3:8, "Finally, all of you have that unity of mind, sympathy, brotherly love, and a tender heart, and a humble mind." Again, sympathy, caring for one another, love from God, having that tender heart, and having that humble mind of knowing whose we are and whose we belong to. First of all, we'll take a look at sympathy. What does he say in Romans 12, 15? "Rejoice with those who rejoice and weep with those who weep." You know, sometimes we may weep with those who weep, but rejoicing with somebody who's rejoicing, and when things aren't going so well for ourselves, sometimes that's hard to do. But our Lord desires that He would give us the strength, yes, to have that same heart towards one another, identifying how that other person is feeling and what they may be experiencing. Number two, the love. What do the following verses say about God's love for us? Already back in Deuteronomy, verse 7, 9, "Know therefore that the Lord your God is God, the faithful God who keeps covenant and steadfast love with those who love Him and keep His commandments to a thousand generations. Yes, he will be there till our very last day as he's promised. In Psalm 86:15, he says, "But you, O Lord, are a God of merciful and gracious, slow to anger, and abounding in steadfast love and faithfulness." His love is there, abounding for us also as we look to him. Zephaniah 3:17, "The Lord your God is in your midst, a mighty one who will save you. He will rejoice over you with gladness." We are to rejoice over the Lord, but have you ever thought of, yes, he rejoices over you as you trust him. Not because you understand everything, but you're trusting his word for what he's doing. He will quiet you with his love. We need that quietness even today through the pandemic and all the frustrations that are going on. He says he will quiet you with his love. He will exalt over you with loud singing. It's a different perspective than what we think of sometimes, how the Lord is rejoicing over us also. And then those precious words in John 15. If you ever get discouraged, take a look at John 14 through 17. "As the Father has loved me, so have I loved you. Abide," or otherwise, "remain in my love. If you keep my commandments, you will abide in my love, just as I have kept my Father's commandments and abide in his love. These things I've spoken to you, that my joy may be in you, and that your joy be half full." No, that your joy may be full. We receive that joy from him and his word. "This is my commandment, that you love one another as I have loved you. Greater love has no one than this, that they should lay down his life for his friends." Sometimes that doesn't necessarily mean laying down our physical life. It means laying down our selfishness, or "I want my way." No, Lord, you give us your wisdom so that we may work in harmony together. He says in Romans 5:8, we have that example of how much he really loves us, even while we were sinners. He said, "But God chose his love for us, and while we were still sinners, Christ died for us." So people don't have to be perfect and do everything the way we think they should do before we can love them and care for them and reach out to them. And those precious words from Romans 8, besides John 14 through 17, ever get discouraged, take a look at chapter 8 of Romans, where he says, "No, in all of these things we are more than conquerors through him who loved us. For I am sure that neither death nor life, nor angels nor rulers, nor things present nor things to come, nor powers nor height nor depth, nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus our Lord." His love is there for us, yes, even during our pandemic. He is there. Nothing can separate us from his love. He encourages us then in Ephesians, "But God, being rich in mercy, because of the great love with which he loved us, even when we were dead in our trespasses, he made us alive together with Christ. By grace you have been saved." A dead person can't be very alive, can they, on their own? It takes the living word of God that changes our hearts also to be alive for him and to be able to love one another. As he says, "Beloved, let us love one another, for love is from God. And whoever loves has been born of God and knows God. And anyone who does not love does not know God, because" what? "God is love." True love, the agape love, comes from him and him alone. As we continue on our study, we heard about the sympathy, love, and the other aspect of that 1 Peter verse said, a tender heart. And Ephesians 4 talks about that. "Let no corrupting talk come out of your mouths, but only such as is good for building up, as it fits the occasion, that it may give grace to those who hear. And do not grieve the Holy Spirit of God, by whom you were sealed for the day of redemption. And then let all bitterness and wrath and anger and clamor and slander be put away from you, along with all malice. Be kind one to another, tender-hearted, forgiving one another, as God in Christ forgives you. Yes, as we realize how much He has forgiven us, that gives us the strength, and His Spirit will give us the strength to forgive others and consider others' opinions. Fourthly, a humble mind. Ephesians 4, I therefore, a prisoner for the Lord, urge you to walk in a manner worthy of the calling to be which you have been called, with all humility and gentleness, with patience, bearing with one another in love. He didn't necessarily say it was going to be real easy. He says bearing with one another in love, that love that comes from God, eager to maintain what? That unity of spirit, as our theme is, working together in the bond of peace. That's His desire for us. And then we have that beautiful example of our Lord didn't think it was too much for Him to give up His glory in heaven to come down for us, as we hear in Philippians chapter 2. Having this mind among yourselves, which is yours in Christ, as you remember, we've been baptized into Christ, we're in Christ. That mind of Christ is in you. Let it be flowing through you, which is yours in Christ Jesus, who, though He was in the form of God, did not count equality with God a thing to be grasped, but emptied Himself by taking the form of a servant, being born in the likeness of men, and being found in human form, He humbled Himself by becoming obedient to the point of death, even the death on the cross. Therefore, God has highly exalted Him and bestowed on Him the name that is above every name, so that at the name of Jesus, every knee should bow in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and every tongue confess that Jesus is Lord, to the glory of the Father. That's the greatest purpose we have here on earth, is to bring honor and glory to our Lord. Put on then, as God's chosen ones, holy and beloved, compassionate hearts, kindness, humility, meekness, patience. Again, that word bearing one another. And if one has a complaint against another, do what? Forgive each other as the Lord has forgiven you, so you also must forgive. Release that burden. Lord says vengeance is His. He will repay. Trust. He's big enough to take care of things. We need to receive from Him that strength and that forgiveness. So back to reminding us of what our theme is, and finally, all of you have unity of mind, sympathy, brotherly love, and a tender heart, and a humble mind. 1 Peter 3:8. Having that unity of mind, it all really comes from the love of God. It comes and starts out with Jesus Himself here, and that love flowing down from Jesus, from God Himself, to our love, we're enabled then to have sympathy and a tender heart. As it comes from Jesus, it goes over to that sympathy and to that tender heart. He is there for us. And as we have that coming there, these two are connected, having sympathy and a tender heart. You can't really have a tender heart without sympathy, and sympathy without it flows, and these two are really together. That tender heart comes from our Lord Himself. Again, it's that agape love that follows through. And then what happens with that tender heart? That tender heart also goes out to a humble mind. It flows through in that sympathy. You have that unity of mind, what we talked about earlier, where you rejoice with those who rejoice, and you weep with those who weep. And then that unity of mind is connected. Over together, also these are tied together. A humble mind, there's going to be a unity of mind, because we're all one body together with Jesus Christ Himself. And again, it's that love coming down from Jesus, not just because we get reactions back from what people do or say to us. No, agape love is love that comes from our Lord, and He is there for us each day. And that flows through to us all to His glory and to His praise. And God will grant that to us. God's love comes down to us through Jesus Christ, through His Word, through His gifts that He gives to His body, His church. And because of God's love, how are we able to accept others and be able to work together? God's love moves us to love others. His love moves us to put others before ourselves. This includes putting aside the attitude of having our way in our families, our congregations and societies and workplaces and communities. God's love moves us to kindness, tenderness, and caring for one another. Through the faith that He gives us, God moves us to acknowledge Him as Lord and works in us to be humble. That humbleness comes from Him, and His strength will be with us as we look to Him each day. When God blesses us with His gifts of unity of mind, sympathy, brotherly love, a tender heart, and a humble mind, that's a lot in that scripture verse of 1 Peter 3:8. We are able to set aside our differences and accept others. Yes, even as sinners, God loved us, so we love one another also. Again, don't forget that verse. Finally, all of you, not just some, all of you, have that unity of mind, sympathy, brotherly love, a tender heart, and a humble mind. By the power of the Holy Spirit, we are enabled to welcome their ideas, suggestions, and help in order to spread God's love by serving others together. And we do that even as we unite in prayer. As He says, if any two of you agree upon anything here on earth, that's real unity that He's emphasizing the importance of. He gives us the desire for us to pray and to commit things to Him. We go to our Lord in prayer. We thank You, Lord, that Your love is at the center of our lives. Your love created us and redeemed us. Help us to love our sisters in Christ here today, so that we may have sympathetic and tender hearts toward each other. Give us unity of mind and humility, so that all our words and actions honor You and build others up. Lead us and guide us to accept others and to work together. We ask this all in the name of Jesus. Amen. We then sing the song, LSB 700, Love All Excelling, as we magnify and worship our Lord. And that song is public domain, both the text and the tune. Love divine, all loves excelling.
Thank you, Pastor, for encouraging us to take to heart the theme of our Bible study today and work together for the benefit of the Lord's people. Earlier this month, the board of the Springfield Zone, which includes officers and the Zone Society presidents, met via Zoom. The board voted to re-elect Pam Gross for a second term as our vice president. Pastor Spilker, if you will install Pam at this time, we will be able to move forward as the complete board.
We're installing the vice president of the Springfield Zone in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. You have been called into the service of our Lord through the Lutheran Women's Missionary League. The women of this organization have honored you by placing their trust and confidence in your abilities as a Christian leader. You, in turn, will honor our Lord by performing your duties to the best of your ability. In all your tasks, we look to God for guidance in His Word. Let each of you look not only to his own interest, but also to the interest of others, Philippians 2:4. May you be strengthened with all power according to his glorious might for all endurance and patience with joy, Colossians 1:11. Put on love, which binds everything together in perfect harmony, Colossians 3:14. In the presence of God and your fellow members, do you, Pam Gross, as vice president, accept the office to which you have been elected, and will you faithfully fulfill the required duties as God gives you grace, strength, and wisdom to the glory of Christ our Lord and in his service to the LWML? If so, answer yes with the help of God.
Yes, with the help of God.
And now to you, dear sisters, even though you're not here present, in your own homes, God is with you, and we ask that you make a commitment to being supportive of the position that she has and to the LWML. Dear sisters in Christ, having heard God's word and the promise of your officer, do you intend to encourage, help, and respect your elected leader? Do you intend to rededicate yourself to being living members of this organization? If so, then answer, we do. We go to our Lord in prayer. May God bless you, elected officer and member, with his Holy Spirit, that you may prove faithful stewards of Christ our Lord. Let us pray. Gracious God, grant us, your servants, every spiritual gift necessary to complete our task in harmony with your plans for us and for this organization. Lead us to discover our greatest potential as well as our limitations. Help us to accept the humanity of one another. Most of all, instill in all of us daily dependence upon you, our loving Father. Amen. And now the God of peace make you perfect in every good work to do his will, working in you that which is well-pleasing in his sight, through Jesus Christ, to whom be glory forever and ever. Amen.
Thank you, Pastor. I'm so happy to have Pam as our VP again. We have big plans for her here in the zone. At this time, Pastor Mark Miller, president of the Central Illinois District of the Lutheran Church Missouri Synod, has some words of greeting and wisdom for us. Pastor Miller.
Welcome to all those who are attending LWML fall rallies this September, and we bring our welcome as the CID president, but also my personal welcome and my thoughts go out to you in regards to our continuing to pray for you. This is sort of a reminder of what St. Paul says in many of his opening sentences to his epistles, here especially from 1 Thessalonians chapter 1. We give thanks to God always for all of you, constantly mentioning you in our prayers, remembering before our God and Father your work of faith and labor of love and steadfastness of hope in our Lord Jesus Christ. Every day I pray for the parishes, the people, the pastors, and parochial schools of our Central Illinois district. And in my prayers, I ask that the Lord would send in rich measure His Holy Spirit to us, that we might be able to do His work, to perform His mission, and to lift up His name in glory. And so here St. Paul, as I said, in many of his introductory sentences to his epistles, talks about always praying, remembering in his prayers the people of God in particular locations, but I think it even touches us in these present days, in this present time, under the present circumstances, to know how comforting it is to know that prayers are being offered in our behalf, and just not our own prayers individually, but our collective corporate prayers being offered, so that God's word continues to go out and have effect among us. I want to thank all the ladies for what they do, and I do this constantly, I think, when I attend rallies, but thanking the ladies for their participation and their work for the Lord done within their families, within their congregations, and also within their communities. And we pray that God would also bless those works to His greater glory. I always thank God in your behalf, knowing that He has touched your life so that you might be a blessing to others. And we rejoice that because of what our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ has done in giving Himself in sacrifice in our behalf to take care of our sin and to make it possible for us to have continuing fellowship with our Heavenly Father, not only now, but also throughout eternity when we join Him in the bliss of heaven. In the meantime, we are involved in works of love. The gospel has had an impressive work done in us, and we can't help but do those things that, here again, are for the welfare of our neighbor, but also to the benefit of the kingdom, and also to the glory of our God. So once again, I thank all of you for all your efforts done, wherever you might be throughout the Central Illinois District. And I thank God that He continues to use you and will do so, and that you will be willing servants in His kingdom. Once again, welcome. God's blessing to you. And I look forward to the time when we can meet in person again, and hopefully that'll be real soon. The Lord be with you. Thank you.
Thank you, Pastor Miller. It's time for our business meeting. I refer you to your agenda for the minutes of the rally of September 2019. If you have any corrections for the minutes, please let your president know by September 30th. Otherwise, I will assume they are correct as printed. Our treasurer, Judy Carlson, has sent a printed report, which is also included in the agenda. We have a total of $1,176.96 in our account. One-third of that money has always been intended to pay the expenses of the zone president to go to the national convention. But not every president uses it, so we have accumulated a little more money than usual. I do want to remind you that all of our zone's money comes from the voluntary $15 operating contribution to the zone. It would be helpful if these monies would be sent to Judy by October 1st. In reference to her report, if I don't hear any corrections by September 30th, her report will be filed for audit. I have quite a few items to bring up regarding district and national activities in the coming months. Grab Our Shoes and Go is the theme for the district's 9th and 10th October retreat at Camp Silka. Registration forms have been sent or will be sent later this month. This is a live event, so I hope you will look over the information and sign up if you feel comfortable going. The theme for the LWML Sunday this year is Kingdom People Produce Kingdom Fruit, found in Matthew 2:43. All the materials are available now for download at www.lwml.org. I've seen the pictures and the covers, and they're very beautiful, so I hope you will use them for your service. Angel Tree Ministry is going virtual this year, too. The society presidents voted to do this as a zone. However, it is voluntary for each society. I do need to know by October 1st how many children we are willing to sponsor. The cost to us is $22 per child. Each child will receive a $20 gift card, Christian materials, and a Bible. All we do is send the money. Angel Tree makes sure it gets to the right children, so we make no phone calls, we bake no cookies, we gather no crafts, and we don't host a party that nobody comes to. But we will know that every child who needs a Christmas gift from their parent who is incarcerated will get one. Again, please let me know by October 1st how many children your society or individual members are willing to give a child a gift for Christmas. Well, we are going to give our 75th anniversary celebration another shot. April 29th through May 1st, 2021 is the new date for Proclaiming Jesus, 75 years of serving the Lord with gladness. We will have the same speakers, agendas, and activities as planned for May 2020. Let's make plans now to travel to Morton. The last upcoming event, but certainly not the least, is the National Convention to be held in Lexington, Kentucky on June 24th through 27th, 2021. Running the race looking to Jesus is the theme based on Hebrews 12, verses 1 and 2. I hope many of you are planning to attend. I'm really looking forward to it, and I am hoping and praying a COVID-19 vaccine will be available to make it possible for all of us to attend safely. Yesterday, I received a survey in the mail from the district office, and I'm going to forward it to your presidents, and they will send it to you. Please take just 2 or 3 minutes to fill this out and give them an idea about what everyone is thinking about attending. Once again, the district is sponsoring a bus to the convention. In order to decide which bus line will work best for us, they're asking us to let us know by the end of September if there is any interest. So if you want to go, please let your president know so she can send me your names so I can get us on the list. We are not obligated at all, but they would like to know interest. VP Pam attended the July district board meeting in my place this summer. We were quite surprised to learn that our zone is responsible for the district banner for the national convention this year. Fortunately for us, we have a talented artist and needlewoman in our vice president, Pam. By the time she came home from the meeting, she had a design in mind. Within a week, she was executing it. I'm going to have her take a minute now to explain and show what she has done. Pam?
And now I'd like to interview my lovely bride, as she's a very talented lady, and she's going to be working on the banner for next year's LWML International Convention in Louisville, running the race. And she has assembled a beautiful collection of chrismons that she has also hand-stitched that will be going onto this banner. I'd like to ask her a few things about what she's putting onto the banner. And again, you can see it is Let Us Ever Walk with Jesus as we gather together for the convention. And we here, of course, in the Central Illinois District are glad to have her. I see you're going to be using, what kind of fabric will you be having there for this banner?
It'll be on the back, so it'll just be the cleanup for all the stitching. And this is a cross shape, and I'll be using white ribbon, and then we'll have the alpha, and they have the omega, and I'm gonna plan to put those on in beads, and it's going to tell about Christ's life. And we'll have Central Illinois at the bottom, and we'll have, here's one example. This is the manger, the nativity, and I have an angel, the nativity, a star. The star will have beads and embroidery. And I have the Trinity, the ichthus, a Cairo. Here's the ichthus, it has embroidery and gold beads on it. And baptism shell, the Lamb of God, the communion with the wafer, and the dove, and the butterfly for resurrection, and the candle for...
It's Christ is the light of the world.
Light of the world. And the doves for the Holy Spirit.
Well, it looks like it'll be very, very beautiful. And I'm sure the ladies at the convention will be blessed by it. And so we thank you very much for your efforts. And we're really looking forward to seeing the final product.
We just don't know the dimensions. So if anybody could tell me the dimensions when they know, it would be very helpful.
All right. Well, thank you very much.
You're welcome.
God bless.
Thank you.
Thank you, Pam and Pastor. I've seen some of these pieces in person. It is truly going to be beautiful. And when Laura carries that banner into the convention hall and the spotlights hit it, it's going to be dazzling. If you attend rallies, you know that we always have an in-gathering and an offering. With a physical in-gathering impossible, rally chairman Cheryl Long and I decided we would have a Megamic collection instead. If you need reminding about our mission grants that we voted on in the spring, they're also available on your agenda. Normally, by our October board meeting, we present the first mission grant of $30,000 for student aid to church workers to District President Mark Miller. As of yesterday, we have $19,000 of that money collected. So you can see we have quite a ways to go to get to our $78,750 district goal. And when you add another 25% for national mites, our total is $105,000 that we need to raise by March. If you haven't sent in rally mega mites already, I urge you to do so also by October 1st. We also have an offering at our rallies, and these monies go to operating expenses for the district. If you feel so moved, this offering can be included too. Use the form that is attached to your agenda and either send it to your society's treasurer or to our zone treasurer, Judy Carlson. Her address is found in the agenda. The work of the Lord still goes on despite our current situation. May these monies further the kingdom in ways that we cannot even imagine. Usually at our rallies, a president or vice president of the district speaks to tell what is going on with the district and national. Our president, Laura Stratman, has made a PowerPoint which can be accessed on our LWML CID website. I encourage all of you to click on the link and listen to Laura's report. Some huge thank yous are in order in the production of this virtual rally. I want to thank the pastors who came in, did their recordings, and gave their presentation. I also want to give a special thanks to Cheryl Long for handling the invitations, the forms, and for her invaluable advice. But this virtual rally would not have been possible without the technology skills of Pastor David Benning of St. John's Lutheran Church here in New Berlin. How wonderful that our rally was ordained to be at this church this year. I can't thank him enough for everything that he has done for the recording, editing, and posting, and all the advice he gave us on what would work best. Thank you so much, Pastor Benning. Now we come to the close of our rally. With the help of our organist, Cheryl, we will sing Lutheran Women, One and All. Just know that whenever you sing, or wherever you sing, the Lord will hear our song of praise, and it will be a delight to his ear across time and space. And now I ask the Lord to bless and keep all of us safe and healthy and safely tucked under the shadow of his wing, now and always. Amen. Will you join me in singing Lutheran Women One and All as our closing?